Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Right On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Today's guest is actor, writer, director Laure de Clermont-Tonnerre. Laure will be telling us about her feature directorial debut, The Mustang, the film based on her award-winning short, Rabbit. Laure de Clermont-Tonnerre, welcome to Right On.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Glad to have you on. Let's talk about how you got started into show business in general, because you started primarily as an actor, right?
Yes, I actually was raised by two film producers' parents. I grew up as a child on movie sets and traveling with my family. My little brother and I were always following our parents during their shooting. And yes, I started acting with them on their films. And then as a teenager, I started to have interest for history, journalism. So I did a master of history. But then I went back to acting and I loved watching films. I was also educated by my parents to watch a lot of various works from different filmmakers all around the world and old films. So it kind of like trained my appetite for cinema. But also I think underneath it was kind of, I knew I wanted to at some point try directing, but I was not ready until the day where I directed this play. I was 25 years old, and that was a big discovery because I loved working with actors and directing actors. And with my background as an actress, there was something that I knew how to do or how to explore in with the good buttons. And so that was this experience really like changed my perspective of career. And I decided to write my first short film. And 2 or 3 years later, I directed it. And that was it. I was on my right shoes.
Wow.
I thought that was actually much more made for me than acting. I loved acting, but I felt I was always fighting against a current, against something that was not completely natural.
Oh.
Directing is obviously very challenging, but I feel that I'm much more viscerally connected to what I do when I direct.
You get the entire body of the, not just that one role, but you get the entire body of the piece at that point, right?
Yes, absolutely. And also I feel that it's more corresponds much more to my nature of carrying, getting into touching different fields, making decision, moving forward. There's something about acting that I love. Obviously, it's a wonderful job, but it's just you're too dependent of people's choices. And at some point, I felt that it was against my nature.
So then what happens as you continue? I mean, the short, let's talk about Rabbit, how that comes together. And then how did that work?
My first short film was Atlantic Avenue. And then I did a second. So I shot it in Brooklyn, in New York, and that it got some attention. So that allowed me to do another short film, Rabbit. And Rabbit came from the fact that I read this article by coincidence on a French magazine about animal therapy in prison. I didn't know nothing about it, got very intrigued because I love animals and I always got very interested into the sense of punishment. Why would you punish someone? What's the impact of punishment? What's happening in prison? So I felt that this subject was reuniting two fields that I got very interested in. So yeah. Wrote Rabbit, I directed it in Rikers Island in New York because I wanted to work with the same crew. So I set it up in New York. And then by exploring a little more about the subject, I found this prison in Nevada who were doing therapy with white horses. So that was the feature film.
For sure. I mean, it flows so naturally out of that. And I mean, you found the real thing. I got to ask about Rikers because you can't just show up with a camera and say, hey, I want to film here. That's got to be pretty tough to do.
No, it's very, very challenging. We got like, we were in a good moment where Rikers Island were hosting shootings at that time. Like not that much, like there was maybe 2 commercial and a music video, and we were the first short narrative to shoot there.
Wow.
Because we had an abandoned building. And for several years, this abandoned building was just fine for shooting. But then now they close it off again because they're renovating this building. So there's no other places in Rikers where you can shoot. So it was kind of where like we benefited from a good circumstances, and I'm glad we did it because it was such a it's such a creepy element. It's a very old prison, but the texture are so interesting, and all those contrasts and colors and huge architecture. It was a great setup for rabbits. So yeah, we got lucky on this one.
And then you find out about the program in Nevada. Obviously, you did not shoot at New York again, judging by the scenery here. So, did you shoot in Nevada? Did you find the same place to go?
Absolutely, we did. Yeah, we did. We got very I mean, it was a long fight. I did all my research there, and for me the location is very important to anchor a story. So this story was naturally anchored in Nevada, and what really struck me about that place is the visual contrast between those rigid fences of this prison, nested in the beautiful Rocky Mountains of Nevada, like very desertic with this explosive nature. So it added like all those Western elements that I really wanted to portray, and for me it was obvious that we needed to shoot in that location, but at that time we didn't have incentive. There was a lot of issues. So for years we had to explore other options, and it was very sad because I could never find like the feeling or the emotion I had the first time I went to this prison in Nevada. So I was trying to accommodate production, but inside me I was like, no, we have to shoot in Nevada. So I was fighting and fighting and fighting. And finally, after multiple obstacles, we got just 3 months before shooting, we got the authorization to shoot in this abandoned prison, which is adjacent of this active prison in Nevada. So it was the same landscapes, and we had this huge space for us, and we could build the camp, the farm, and it was kind of a mini studio where on a very tight schedule, it really helped us to do, to make the days, but also to find like to anchor the story in such an authentic field. That was really important. Yeah.
Cast and crew really feels like they are there because they are.
Exactly. And also being in Nevada, it allowed me to have former inmates on board with us, like as actor, because they're all living around. So it's everything is born there. I really believe that locations and when you feel inspired by a subject in a specific landscape and nature element, you have to fight for it because it's gold.
That is gold. That is the great stuff. Let's talk a little bit more about the Mustang and your process and, how you start this. Obviously, you mentioned research, but what's the first step in writing a script for you?
I had a collaborator on my first draft, and because we didn't really deeply research at that time, so we did this draft about this simple story of man and horse connection, but a little bit more distant. It's funny because I feel that draft after draft, as I was learning and deepening the characters and the story, the point of view became much more tight and attached to the main character. And I felt that it was my point of view becoming much more internal and much more immersed into the story as I was actually acknowledged about it. So I can see that difference, like this evolution. It really mature into the POV, obviously, but the simplicity, a lot of subplots that got out. I understood that it was a very simple story to tell, and it had to be like as pure and as like light as possible.
So we get on set. What's the first stuff, the first footage you guys start shooting? Where do you begin?
We started with Matthias in solitary confinement. We started everything inside the prison, inside the cells, because we wanted to finish with the horses. We had 3 weeks after with the horses. First week only with Matthias and the prison and the inmates, and then 3 weeks with horses. So it was just allowing the horse trainer to have a little bit more time with horses and to have them more set up, like settle down. And also, it was better for us to start with lighter scenes. Was easier, it was to enter into the story. It was also the beginning of it. We tried to be as chronological as possible. So we started with the first 2 days of solitary confinement, and it helped us, Matthias, the crew, and I to get started.
Really have a chance to kind of get your rhythm as a crew, right?
Yeah,
Yeah,
absolutely.
that's what winds up changing as you're on set? You start small and work out. What do you learn as you're starting small? What changes?
When you're starting small, I mean, when you're starting with the easier scenes,
Yeah.
it just like it's can kind of challenge and test a little bit the chemistry of the crew and make sure that you know things are running in on a little bit easier environment, more confined and a little bit less challenging. And then you feel that this first week is good to bond and to kind of get like the rhythm and everyone's kind of like more used to each other and are more able to face big challenges. So
Right.
if we had started with the big scenes with horses, I think it would have been really chaotic. So, I mean, it was a chaotic shoot, but if we really wanted to enter slowly into this crazy 23 days race of shooting.
In 23 days, wow. I mean, then you have the horses for that so much. It's always tough to direct with animals because you can't totally control everything. I mean, they're outside pretty much the entire time. So there's a lot of challenges just there logistically. What were some of those like?
So the challenges was obviously I anticipated working with horses because I knew it was kind of a big part of the challenge, but I was very surprised how disciplined they were. I have to say that sometimes they were more disciplined than the men in the crew. No, just to we had a wonderful horse trainer and a wonderful horse wranglers team who were so cautious with the horses, so respectful, who knew exactly how to work with them, to collaborate with them. So without them, I don't think we would have made half of it. Obviously, it was like the key of the success of the shoot is to have the right people training the horses and make sure that they were collaborating. And if they were not, because obviously animals are animals, we had like three similar horses for the main one so that we could change horses if one was tired or was not in the mood to do something. We had always another horse that we could work with. So that was very helpful. We also had two cameras, which was very helpful because sometimes we had to capture to roll for like 10 minutes because we wanted to have like a very specific reaction or specific moments between man and horse. So it was a lot of adaptation to them. And this is what I wanted. I wanted a camera, a very loose and very sensorial camera who could capture the unpredictability of the horse and the man and all their dialogues.
Yeah, there's a lot there. You were mentioning two cameras, but are you saying, I'm a little confused, you had two cameras just different angles at the same time, right?
Yes, exactly. We
Okay.
wanted to have angles at the same time, so we're always with two cameras. When
Yeah.
it comes for horses, it was always like two.
Yeah, you just have to have that extra coverage. So what were the big story changes as you were getting through shooting? Did stuff change?
The big challenges were, I mean.
I'm sorry, changes, not necessarily challenges, but the how did the script rearrange?
Oh, the script. We did some improvisation. I mean, obviously, everything was scripted. The invisible dialogue between men and horses will definitely kind of happen on set. And Matthias was extremely responsive and very invested emotionally. The horse was very well trained, but was also like had also his moments of improvisation and surprise. So it was kind of like magic accidents, you know? We
Sure.
wanted to allow those magic accidents to happen, so it definitely room for improvisation and for and to wait and to wait for the golden moment, for the right reaction, for the so it's I have to say that we sculpted while we were shooting it. It was very exciting because it was kind of like a little more documentary approach, and I always love that because you never know what you're gonna get. But when you get something very special, then it's like, okay, I know why I'm doing this job. It's just for this kind of magic. Yes, so that was like and also like there's one therapy scene that we kind of changed by doing it. I came up with multiple version of that scene, like the session therapy scene, and then I think like right in the morning I came up with like an updated version that was pretty different, and that was the one we shot.
Wow.
So sometimes you have to be very open and aware of kind of last minute changes, but I think they're very valuable.
Yes, absolutely. And that's a great way to start. There is another character question I wanted to ask because Roman's character in general is not, I mean, he's a good character, but he's not a charismatic guy. And I think that can be risky. You went for it. And then as we find out more about why he's in prison, it's not just a guy who was, wrong place, wrong time, happened in jail. I mean, this was bad. It's really ugly. And it's, that's a really bold character choice, and I wonder how much you wrestled with that, or how much you changed that over time.
I knew I wanted to have a very numb character who is in complete darkness, and he's going to warm up and unfold with the contact of the horse, and like his emotions are going to surface like bubbles getting out of a mental statement. So it was hard because you have to find the right actor who, even though you are numbed, you're still exciting to watch, you know, and that's not easy to find. The best example was Harry Dean Stanton in Paris, Texas. You have a very numb character, but still his impulse is so intriguing and so odd. And you're like, what's going on in that? What's the mystery behind? It's exactly what I wanted for Roman. I wanted someone who had, you feel like it's really broken, but he's completely opaque, and you want to kind of get into, engaged into his story. And that's why I wanted him to be unfold and to be more likable before revealing his crime. Because I didn't want anyone to judge Roman before knowing what he's been, you know, what he has done.
Yeah.
I wanted people to fairly and objectively learn to know this man, understand his personality and his flaws, and then eventually give him a second chance. But that's a very objective question that I'd like, through this film, to ask the audience. Mm-hmm. What do you do with, like, knowing this crime after spending an hour with this man who has a real potential? What do you do with that? Do you support a second chance? Do you want to believe into it? This is exactly how I felt when I was in prison, listening to a lot of stories, talking with very charming and smart and articulate men, and then knowing what he has done. And like, okay, this is, I mean, people are, shouldn't be defined by their crimes and should definitely get a second chance and have a hope in the future. Because when you're capable of love and empathy, you are you're definitely able to change your trajectory.
And I think that what you did with this character is much more bold. I think the easy way out would have been, you know, to make his crime much more forgivable. But yeah, that would make the second chance question so much easier. But as an audience, we really have to stop and think and actually feel for this guy.
And it's not like forcing anyone to have a, you know, it's not like kind of also influence the judgment. It's very objective, because I feel that people really have to ask this question. It's really important. Also, you know, like concerning the fields of massive incarceration, you have to consider those humans who deserve a second chance. Not everyone, but most of them, I believe. Yeah.
How do you build out the rest of the characters around them, both in the writing and maybe even the casting and directing?
To this character, how did I build him?
The ones around Roman, I mean, the other supporting characters throughout the movie.
What I loved about this program, the real program in Nevada, and it's like this lightness and humor and solidarity and camaraderie that you can feel when you go there. It's the prison is a place where racial rules and political rules are so rigid and so serious that you can't really find a lot of humor. And when you go to this program, you don't have skin colors anymore. You don't have a community or religion, or you have a group of men, whoever they come from, who have fun training wild horses and have the same passion and help each other and leave their passion together. And it's such an experience. They're cemented by the horse. And that's, I really want, sometimes you get there and you're like, oh, am I in prison? It feels like you're completely in apparent freedom, which is definitely an illusion. But I thought that that story needed to have those moments light. And the light comes from Henry. The light comes from Tom. The light comes from Miles, those characters who believe into what they do, who wants to communicate the passion, who find a sense of their life, who are already on the other side. Roman is not there yet, but he's going to be. And I thought the camaraderie and the group of men together bonding, but then in the yard, because of this stupid prison rule, they're not allowed to acknowledge each other, just to say hi. I thought, I remember that I was very deeply affected by this experience going there, and I really wanted to portray that.
Wow, it really comes across. Well, it's a fantastic movie. Really enjoyed it. I hope people will see it. Can you let people know where they can see the Mustang?
Yes, absolutely. March 15 in New York and Los Angeles, Landmark, Arclight, and then the following week it's going to be like in five major cities, and then the week after it's 200 screens. So I hope that much as I mean, people who loves those kind of story will come and see the film.
Yeah, all right. So that's March 29th. We see it in, you said 200 screens.
Yes.
That's great. Well, Laure de Clermont-Tonnerre, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
If you're out there listening, that means you're a much appreciated Right On listener. Join us as we listen to other podcasts. Let us know if you like this podcast by leaving those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc. And we're on Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, right on.